One man, one mission, to rid the world of chronic anxiety once and for all. The Anxiety Guy, Dennis Simsek, shares his personal transformation from living a life filled with overwhelming worry to becoming a full-fledged positivity machine, a leading authority in generalized anxiety. Dennis gets to the truth of your mental health challenges and sets you on a path to transforming each and every area of your life. Here he is, the one and only, the Anxiety Guy.
Hey everyone, and welcome to episode number 108 of the Anxiety Guy podcast. Dennis Simsek here with you today. And I decided that today would be a good day to tackle something that many, many people are suffering with today. And it's a very, very confusing feeling. And I get a lot of questions on it. And I also did a Facebook Live recently on this. So I know that the audience there already has heard some of this stuff, but today's the day I go deeper than I ever have when it comes to depersonalization, my friends. So if you're suffering from it, or if you know somebody that's suffering from depersonalization, you are in for a treat. I will reveal the causes, I will reveal what to do, and I will also reveal what it feels like. Now, what is depersonalization? It depends on the individual. That's the truth. Because depersonalization for me was a feeling of my sensory organs not working properly at some points of the day, but also working excessively at other times of the day. For instance, I was feeling something, but I wasn't really feeling it, if that makes any sense. I was seeing something, but I wasn't really seeing it. I wasn't sure how close it was, how far it was. It was as if I was living within this bubble, and I was looking through the bubble nonstop. And a lot of times I felt like I was in a dreamlike state, or the boat was like swaying. It was almost like I was on a boat constantly. And it was just this weird sensation as if I was really dizzy and I couldn't get my balance. So it differs between person to person. Everybody has their own cognitive, physical challenges when it comes to depersonalization. Now, I'm going to give you guys a couple of the causes, okay? And when I'm giving you these causes, let me make this very, very clear. Depersonalization is very confusing. Psychologists, doctors, practitioners, coaches, it's a bit of a guessing game if you think about it. There is no straight answer when it comes to depersonalization, but I have seen many, many patterns that people run that then causes them to feel depersonalized and derealized. And those are the things that I'm going to go into today because I stand behind each and every one of these, my friends. The first cause is an overuse of the fight or flight response, a response by the system to limit the use of internal energy sources. So what happens is the fight or flight response is constantly on, that stress response. You're always stressed. So what the system does is it shuts a lot of parts down, and therefore you begin to use less internal energy and less resources to numb you from that sensitized state that you're constantly in. So if someone finds themselves in a constant fight or flight response cycle, they are going to find themselves eventually, possibly, in depersonalization, in this depersonalized state. So the first thing is the fight or flight response is on 24 hours a day, constant. It's just too much for the system to handle. So it starts collapsing and shutting down certain parts of the system in order to deal with everyday life. Number two cause is depletion, mental and emotional exhaustion. Are you exhausted? Are you mentally, you know, trying to pinpoint and cognitively make sense of every one of your 60 to 75,000 thoughts that you get every single day? Are you emotionally so engaged in everything that you do and you find the worst possible scenario in everything? This is anxiety. If you're feeling this depleted, there's a good chance that, again, the system will detect this state and it will create depersonalization within you. So depletion is another cause. Third cause is a bad use of the imagination, living too much in the future and not enough in the present. Now, I want to give you guys a deeper understanding of this. Now, first things first, when I talk about what's called first position means that you see everything from your own point of view. Okay, let's make that really, really clear. First position is everything is from my point of view. I don't take anybody else's point of view. I don't see things from their eyes or their perspectives or a bystander's perspective. I see it from my perspective. This is first position. Second position is when you begin to understand things from another person's point of view. That's called second position. Third position is when you begin to understand things and the situation and the scenario from a bystander's point of view. Not yours, not the person you're communicating with, but from somebody who's looking at this from the outside. That's third position. Now, let me explain something. When people live too much in the future or too much in the past, they are living in first position. Everything is from their point of view. Oh, my past used to be so brilliant. I wish I could go past that. I just hope and wish that my future could be well. You know, I hope and wish I could feel much better than I am today. I dread the future. I. Everything is from first position. But let me explain something. What if you took your anxiety and what you're going through right now and put it into second position? Seeing things from another person's point of view, or seeing things from a bystander's point of view. What would happen then? Would there be perceptions that you would be more open to and tap into? Would you be seeing your thought patterns, your belief systems, your actions differently than you do? I urge you to step into this because too many people are living too much in the future and too much in the past. And the problem is that even when you do go and try to find some information or some knowledge and you work with someone or you listen to podcasts or videos, you are so much in the future or so much in the past that you cannot be in the present enough to understand and take in that information. That's a problem. And then people say, I tried everything. I did everything I could. Well, guess what? You weren't in the moment. You weren't absorbed. You weren't focused on what you were doing because you were so in the future and past. So I urge you to practice this kind of self-discipline in order for yourself to put yourself in the current state, in this present moment as much as you can, and to bring your focus from all these different thoughts and judgmentalism and all this sort of stuff, and to escape from judgmentalism, to judge something so harshly, someone, yourself, and to get back into the present moment and be absorbed in what you're learning, such as today. The fourth cause of depersonalization is repressed emotion. Repressed emotion, not dealing with and coming to terms with different circumstances from your past. Every unit of energy that you keep locked up in your system, a memory, information, what happened in the past, you are going to need an equal amount of energy to keep it there, and therefore that leads to emotional depletion. You must finalize things. You must begin seeing things from another person's point of view when it comes to those things that you're repressing. You must change the perception. I say this all the time. When I work with someone one-on-one through Skype, I'm not thoroughly interested in what happened to that person. What I'm interested in is how they perceive what happened. I'm not interested in all the information. I don't care. I couldn't care less. What I'm interested in is how you see it, how you view it, how you hear it. That's what's important. Change the perception, you change the judgment, therefore you change the emotion. So, The fourth reason for depersonalization is you are repressing the emotions. You haven't dealt with things from the past. You haven't come to a conclusion. You haven't finalized things. You are beating yourself up over what happened or beating someone else up. You are living with guilt. You are living with fear. Today's the day that you begin brainstorming which repressed emotions are causing your depersonalization and or your anxiety, my friends. Now, here's the question, is how do we help someone with depersonalization? So I'm going to go through these one by one, and I want to make them clear so that you can begin tapping into this language and altering the way you feel. Maybe not right away, but in time. First thing is first. Where does 20% of your conscious focus go daily that is causing 80% of the problems? Brainstorm. So many times, 20% of someone's focus is causing 80% of the internal problems. I ask you this question, where is your stress response coming from? Where? Is it from the past? Is it from something in the present? Is it from something that may happen in the future? So brainstorm where your focus is going that is causing all this internal energy to be used up in a bad, unproductive way. Number two way to start handling depersonalization is what's called negative visualization. Let me explain. Negative visualization is something that a lot of people have trouble with because visualization creates the outcome that someone desires. The truth is that there are way too many factors, and visualization alone does not create the outcome that someone desires. Negative visualization is when you begin to tap in to something that you're scared of happening. For instance, I'm scared of going to the shopping mall because there's too many people. I had a panic attack there before. I'm scared of panicking. Now let's go a little bit deeper into that. When panic hits, what are you scared of then? I'm scared of people coming around me and judging me harshly, thinking that I'm crazy. What are you scared of then? I'm scared of the ambulance coming and making a big scene. Okay, so it's not so much the panic, it's the judgment, and it's the other things that are going to happen and how people are going to view you a lot of times. Now, negative visualization takes that exact scenario and you start running it in your head in a visualization session. Exactly the thing that you are scared of and trying not to happen. The thing that's causing you anxiety in the first place. When you negatively visualize these things actually occurring, you become immune to those things. They no longer bug you as harshly. They no longer use up so much internal energy. I've been there before. Oh, the panic attack there, the ambulance came. Yeah, whatever. I got judged. It's all good. No problem. Been there. You visualize it a few times. You go to the mall. And when that instinct, that emotion shows up, you're going to tell yourself, you're going to go, you know what? I've been there before and therefore I'm not scared of it. I've visualized it. So negative visualization is a very good tool because depersonalization gets excessive as we begin to tap further and further into the story that might happen to us. The story, the irrational story that we make up through our beautiful imagination, we are misusing our imagination. We are not using it in the right way. We are using our imagination in a way that is causing us more grief, more problems. We don't want that. Third way to overcome depersonalization is mapping. For instance, mapping is this ability for you to sit or lay down and simply not place judgment over each and every feeling, but to observe. So I would start with my feet, calves, knees, quadriceps, stomach, chest, arms, neck, and above, and I wouldn't place judgment on it being a good feeling or a bad feeling. I'm dizzy, I'm this, I'm depersonalized, I'm going to live with it forever. No. It just is. It just is. I'm just observing. You become immune to that. You stop adding emotion to the story, to the initial fear, when you become a master observer of your sensations, of your thoughts. Your thoughts, your emotions, and your sensations are not real. Let me say that again. Your thoughts, your emotions, your sensations are not real. They feel real, but you have the ability to judge them in one way or another, or not to judge them at all. Nothing needs to be good or bad. This is important. You can be neutral about things, even though they don't feel so good. Interesting place to live from. So mapping is very, very important. Number four, see your depersonalization as a companion and not a hindrance. See it as a companion. You're walking the dog. I understand depersonalization. You're saying, Dennis, but it's so debilitating. I get it. I've been there. But it's a companion. And we don't want to add more thoughts, feelings, emotions, behaviors behind what we're already feeling, because that's what keeps it alive. So, it's like walking a dog. Come on, doggy. And I'm walking my depersonalization. If it's going to be with me today, it will be with me. I'm not placing a good or bad judgment around it. I'm not adding a story behind it and what may happen in the store or with my friends or at home, or will it lead to my death, you know, or will I panic? There's no story. I'm just walking the dog. See it as a companion, not a hindrance. Fifth thing you want to do is shift the meaning around it. For instance, I had someone I was working with recently, and I asked them a question. I said, what does that depersonalization feel like? When did you have that before, but it was more of a neutral or pleasant experience? And the first thing that he said was, I remember taking these medications after my surgery and feeling quite good and quite neutral about it. I was dizzy and I was free-flowing and my thoughts, I wasn't attaching myself to anything really. And I said, okay, well, why don't you start seeing your depersonalization the same way you were seeing yourself back then? And he started to go, all of a sudden I start to feel more neutral. Or as if you're on a Ferris wheel, because that dizziness feeling is very similar to a lot of people's depersonalization. Shift the meaning around it. Find a time in your life where the depersonalization feeling you're feeling today is very similar to that pleasant to neutral experience that you had. Same feeling. Number six, slow down. You must work on your speed and you must slow down. You must not agitate the problem. You must not make it worse. You must not add to what's already there. That keeps it alive. That's what keeps your anxiety alive. So, I have to be conscious. I cannot be emotional. The more emotional I get, the more anxiety I'm feeling, the more I'm signaling to my system that I do need that adrenaline. I need that stress response, because how does your reptilian brain work? Your survival brain. Can I eat it? Can I mate with it? Does it threaten me in some way? Those are the questions that are asked by your survival brain. Then the emotional brain attaches itself to that. And next thing you know, we've got problems. Why do we have problems? Because there's no goddamn saber-toothed tiger in today's world. But the mind doesn't know the difference between a pen and an elephant and gravy. It gets excited. Can I eat it? Is it a threat to me? Gravy, the same gravy that was there when you had a panic attack. You may not consciously be aware of it, but it's there. And the unconscious mind sees it. And therefore, sensations, the thoughts, these sort of things occur. And just because something is outside of your awareness doesn't mean it's not affecting you. This is important to understand. So slow down. Slow down your driving speed. Slow down how fast you walk. Slow down how fast you talk. Because I can promise you one thing. I don't know you personally, but I can bet that you do things very, very quickly. Do you not? Your speech? Your walking? Your driving? Your eating? Do you even taste your food? Do you taste the thing that you're drinking? Do you smell it? I don't think so. So it's time to get more conscious and to slow down and to recognize how we're feeding the depersonalization. Number 7 is you want to act out your fears. You want to step away from trying to avoid these fears and step into these fears. Easier said than done, but Dennis, hey, I'm ready. So I'll give you an example. Judgment, embarrassment, being perfect, lack of finances, lack of food, lack of health, all these things. People have these fears, these anxieties that then create this internal turmoil, this friction between the conscious and the unconscious mind. And it turns into things such as emotional problems and even physical problems. So I ask you this, if you're scared of embarrassment, why not put on those pajama bottoms, walk on over to the bookstore and start reading? You're scared of embarrassment? Place yourself in that situation, because guess what? You're going to become immune to it after a while. People are going to look at you. They're going to judge you. They're going to ask you, why the heck are you wearing pajama bottoms at 2 p.m.? Did you just get out of bed? And you go, yeah, I did. And you keep reading. This is how we build inner strength, by stepping into the things that we are trying to avoid. I'm scared of embarrassment. I'm scared of finances. I'm scared of losing all my finances, my money, a lot of people say. Okay, live poor for a week and notice how much fear you actually have then. Live as if you're poor. Notice what starts to happen. Your lack of food. I might not have food. Well, go fast for a little while. Notice what starts to happen. It's so made up in your mind. All of these creations you've created to try to keep away the very thing that you're scared of. And that's causing you further anxiety and depletion. So I ask you, in what way today can you begin to slowly step into those things that you're holding on to, those fears, those limiting things that you continue to play out in your mind that you try to avoid at every cost? You're making it much worse in your mind than it actually is. That I can tell you by experience. My friends, I've gone deep into depersonalization. Understand the causes today and understand what you can do in order to reverse this trend. Listen to this a few times. I love you guys so much. You are more than anxiety. I'll see you soon.
Thanks for being an important part of the Anxiety Guy podcast community. If you enjoyed this podcast, please leave a positive rate and review. If you're searching for further support on your road to recovery from anxiety, head over to anxietyexit.com and take part in the powerful End the Anxiety program based around the CBT model. If you're searching for a more one-on-one approach, you can sign up now for personal coaching sessions with Dennis via Skype. Remember, you are more than anxiety. See you in the next episode.